Greetings and blessed day to you once again, people of God, is the Revelator once again, and hoping the grace and mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ is with you until the end of time. Now, before we enter into today's presentation, I just want to give you a brief reminder of what we covered last time. Last time, we focused on the hell flames and explained about the flames of hell. And hoping those that listen to that presentation, you are equipped by the word of God, which is the word of faith, the word of hope, the word that guides us until the end of time. Now today, we want to focus on a unique presentation, a presentation inside the word of God. And today, I want to explain and present the dark season. And inside the dark season, I want to talk about the trials, tests, and the tribulations, so that you may understand that there is a dark season inside the life of every Christian. And that season is a season which befalls every Christian. It doesn't matter how prayerful you are. But it's a season that comes to test your faith. And it's also a season that comes to weigh you, to see how much weight you have in your faith and in your belief in our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm also going to be explaining the dark season at another level, which is expanded by revelation. Let's go to the book of Matthew chapter 10 verse 5. These twelve Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, "Go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter not." These were the 12 disciples which are being explained here. And Jesus says, "But go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you have received and freely give. Provide neither gold nor silver nor brass in your purses, nor scrip for your journey, neither two coats, neither shoes, nor yet staffs, for the workman is worthy of his meat. And into whatsoever city you enter, inquire in that city who is worthy. And they abide till you move to the next town." The reason why Jesus is telling his disciples to inquire who is worthy in that city is because he understands that it's not everyone that is called for the gospel. You can go from one city to the next preaching the good news, but it is bound and it is possible that you might get frustrated your calling by certain individuals, by certain groups of people that you might try to approach that are not called to be partakers of the gospel that you are preaching. And into whatsoever city that you enter, inquire. And when you inquire, you are also guiding against the persecutions. When you just operate in the spirit without knowing the groups and the types of people, the individuals that you are called for, you are going to attract persecutions. It's one thing to move in the spirit of the Lord in a prophetic dimension, and it's another thing to move in the spirit of the Lord in wisdom. When you move in wisdom, you don't just approach anyone. When you move in the prophetic, you are merely distributing the abilities, not just of the spirit of wisdom only, but of the prophetic. The prophetic is not wisdom, but the prophetic is a spiritual gift. So Jesus is giving his disciples wisdom so that they may know who to inquire, so that they don't end up sacrificing themselves before they've accomplished the mission of the calling. And when you come into any house, salute it. And if the house be worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if the house is not worthy, let your peace return unto you. What kind of houses are these which are not worthy? They are houses which are not worthy. Houses where you are not supposed to enter and share the gospel, because these are not houses which you have been allocated unto, or houses which heaven has allocated unto you as partakers of the gospel. Again, if you enter houses just by being pushed by the zeal of the Lord, you are going to get frustrated again. You are going to come across certain characters whom are not designed to yield to the gospel that you have. And whosoever shall not receive you nor hear your words when you depart of that house or that city, shake off the dust of your feet. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment for that city. Meaning that for those that shall not heed to your words, those that shall not listen to you, your gospel that you are going to present, they shall be like the city of Sodom and Gomorrah, like the days of Noah during the floods. So this scripture is simply trying to enlighten you that these shall face a certain wrath, a wrath that is similar to the wrath that was faced by the citizens of Sodom and Gomorrah and those of the days of Noah when the floods wiped everyone. Then Jesus says, behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. I send you as sheep. Why? Because Jesus is the shepherd. But as the shepherd, I'm sending you as sheep into the midst of wolves. And you know how the wolves are ravening. You know how the wolves are so wild. But Jesus is sending his sheep in the midst of the wolves. Meaning that Jesus is sacrificing his sheep into the wolves. And when Jesus is sacrificing his sheep into the wolves, what it also means is that Jesus is releasing his own sheep, is releasing his own disciples into a season. I'm going to explain that season very soon. It's not a pleasant season. It's a season which one can fail to acknowledge the presence of Jesus. It's a season which one can believe that Jesus is departed. It's a season which you believe that God has departed away from you. It's not a pleasant season, but God will be there watching. But beware of men. But beware of men, for they will deliver you up to the councils, and they will scourge you in their synagogues. All this will be happening while least God will be watching. I'm going to be explaining this kind of season. All this will be watching. God will be watching. People will be watching. Those that have listened to you preaching, they will be watching. They will be watching you as you are in this season. And these scourgings, these afflictions that are being defined here, being scourged in synagogues. You are not being scourged in the world. You are being scourged in the synagogue, right in the presence of the Lord. Before we even want to search why you are being scourged, but you are being scourged right in the presence of the Lord in the synagogue. And you shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and Gentiles. But when they deliver you up, take no thought or how you shall speak and what you shall speak, for it shall be given unto you what you must speak at that very hour, which is evidence that the Lord shall be with you, because he shall actually appear and put inside your mouth what you are supposed to speak. And while least you shall be in that situation, you shall not be in a pleasant situation where the Lord shall appear and then find ways to put inside your mouth. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. And then brother shall deliver up brother to death, and the father and the child, and the children shall rise against their parents and cause them to be put to death. And you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endures to the end shall be saved. The scripture then gives a prescription and says, he that then shall endure to the end shall be saved. Meaning that this is a season that is going to be coming, which shall be very painful. A season where you shall be expected to endure unto the end. Meaning that when you shall be expected to endure unto the end, you are being expected to endure in the trials, in the tests, in the afflictions. And you shall be expected to endure. You shall be expected to go through the process. You shall be expected to go through the season. And that season was never said and will never be easy. According to the scripture relevance, according to the explanation which Jesus is giving his disciples. And the scripture says, you shall be hated of all men. You shall not be loved. It's a season. It's a season of nakedness. It's a season of being rejected. It's a season of being looked down upon. It's a season that Christ never said anything is going to be easy. It's a season of being rejected. It's a season of being condemned. But you need to endure until the end. We're still going to get into detail for us to understand what kind of a season this is. But when they persecute you in this city, flee into another city. Meaning that you're not being given the strength to resist the persecution. The persecutions shall come, but you shall be strengthened. You're not being given the power to resist, to fight back. No. When you get persecuted in this town, you shall flee to the next town. For verily I say unto you, you shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come. Meaning that you are going to be given strength to endure the process. When you get persecuted in this town, you flee to the next town. The scripture never said when you get persecuted in this town, you start fighting back those persecutions. The disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his lord. It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master and the servant as his lord. And they, if they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his own household? The scripture said, if they've called me as Christ, Beelzebub, how much more shall they call you of the household? It means you're going to be given false names. You shall be persecuted. You shall be falsely accused. You shall be reckoned amongst transgressors. You shall be recognized amongst those that are evil. You shall be counted amongst the thieves, the robbers. You shall be counted amongst not those of the kingdom of light, but yet you'll be walking in the brightness of the light of heaven. Fear them not, therefore, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed and hid. Fear them not, therefore, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed and hid that shall not be known. Now, listen to this part. What I tell you in darkness. Why is Christ now saying, what I tell you in darkness? Christ was already giving his disciples all this spiritual advice, this spiritual direction, this compass. Why is it? They were already in a season. And that season was a season of darkness. And he says, what I tell you in darkness, that speak ye in light. Meaning that this was the season of darkness. And Christ is telling them about a season of darkness which they themselves were going to come across. Because this season of darkness was a season of darkness for Christ. Yet he never lost his light. This was the season when Christ was about to be crucified. This was the season when Christ was now entering a season where he was going to be crucified, a season where he was going to be persecuted, a season where he was going to be afflicted, a season where he was now going to be tried by the councils of men, a season where he was going to be condemned and rejected. And he says, what I tell you in the darkness, you speak in the light, and whatever you hear in the ear, you preach it upon housetops. And he then says, fear them not, those that kill the body but are not able to kill the soul. And he was talking about those that persecute this body. He was talking about them that persecute this body, those that afflict this body, those that come and punish this body. He was talking about the season in which the apostles were going to enter. And the season in which the apostles were going to enter, it was the season in the book of Acts. And that season had not yet come. But Christ is saying, what I tell you in darkness, the darkness which Christ was talking about was a season. Not only the season which he was in, but he was dramatizing the season which was yet to come, but while it's already he was in that season. But the season of darkness which he was in was the season in which he was now walking through the valley of darkness. The valley of darkness which was now leading him to be sacrificed. The season in which he was now about to be crucified. And he knew that a similar season was going to befall the disciples. And he was now preparing the disciples for that season which was yet to come. A season which I've already explained that this was not a pleasant season. And I've come here today to explain to you, if you're a disciple, a preacher of the word, an evangelist, a prophet, a teacher of the word, that there is a season that comes, a season which is a season of nakedness. But inside that nakedness, you are still given hope. A season of darkness in which you enter a season of afflictions. A season of darkness in which even when you are a true believer of Jesus Christ, everything around you appears to be crumbling. The world around you appears to be crumbling. The season in which you kneel down and you pray and you feel like the voice of God is far away from you. A season in which you pray and fast. And in all your prayers and fastings, the voice of God continues to just depart away from you. The presence of God continues to be more further, and it goes further more away from you. I'm talking about the season of darkness. The dark season, which is not only a season of darkness, but also there is the last hour of darkness. The last hour of darkness then comes after the dark season. Now, when I'm now talking about the last hour of darkness, we're talking about the last hour in which the end of time shall manifest. And I'm promising you, in the next presentation, which is part of this season, I'll be explaining to you about the last hour of darkness, which is the climax of the dark season. And I want to pray for you that you hold on to your faith if you're a believer and you never give up and you continue praying, you continue fasting, you continue preaching the word, so that when the dark season comes, you don't give up your faith. You remain strong in the name of Jesus.